You want to support Roller March Unfiltered? Be sure to join our Bring the Funk fan club. Every dollar that you give to us supports our daily digital show. There's only one daily digital show out here that keeps it black and keep it real. It's Roland Martin Unfiltered. Support the Roland Martin Unfiltered daily digital show by going to RolandMartinUnfiltered.com. You can make this possible. Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley of Massachusetts. Folks, many of folks know her as one of four members of the squad, incoming member, a new freshman member of Congress who upset a longtime incumbent. She did a video, exclusive video with The Root, where she revealed how she has gone completely bald because of the hair loss condition, alopecia. A lot of folks have been commenting on social media. Here is what she told them.
This is my official public revealing. I have only been bald in the privacy of my home and in the company of close friends. I'm Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley, and this is a word about why my black hair story is both personal and political. Before I was an elected official, I did everything. I wore wigs, I wore extensions, and then about 4 or 5 years ago, I decided to get Senegalese twist all the way down to my waist. And what happened is that I got these Senegalese twist, and I feel like I met myself fully for the first time. You know, I sort of looked in the mirror and I said, oh, there I am. And it felt good. So what started out as a transitional hairstyle ultimately became a statement and something that I was very intentional about. And I was very aware this hairstyle could be, would be, filtered and interpreted by some as a political statement that was militant, or people said, people will think you're angry. And I said, well, they already think that. What I was not prepared for was the glorious gift and blessing of the acceptance and the community and the affirmation. Now I walk into rooms and little girls are wearing t-shirts that say my congresswoman wears braids, and we receive letters from all over the globe of women who talk about their own emancipation, that they feel that I've given them permission. My twists have become such a synonymous and conflated part of not only my personal identity and how I show up in the world, but my political brand. That's why I think it's important that I'm transparent about this new normal and living with alopecia. In the fall, when I was getting my hair retwisted, is the first time that I was made aware that I had some patches. From there, it accelerated very quickly. I had been waking up every morning to sinkfuls of hair. Every night I was employing all the tools that I had been schooled and trained in throughout my life as a black woman, because I thought that I could stop this. I wrapped my hair. I wore a bonnet. I slept on a silk pillowcase. And yet and still every morning, which I faced with dread, I did not want to go to sleep because I did not want the morning to come where I would remove this bonnet and my wrap and be met with more hair in the sink. And an image in the mirror of a person who increasingly felt like a stranger to me. And so, impeachment eve, the last little bit of my hair came out. I was completely bald, and in a matter of hours was going to have to walk into the floor, the House chamber, House of Representatives, and cast a vote in support of articles of impeachment. And so I didn't have the luxury of mourning what felt like the loss of a limb. It was a moment of transformation, not of my choosing.
It is with a heavy heart, but a resolved one, and because I believe our democracy is worth fighting for, I will vote to impeach Donald J. Trump, and I urge my colleagues to do the same.
But I knew the moment demanded that I stand in it and that I lean in. And I exited the floor as soon as I could. And I hid in a bathroom stall. I felt naked, exposed, vulnerable. I felt embarrassed. I felt ashamed. I felt betrayed. And then I also felt that I was participating in a cultural betrayal because of all the little girls who write me letters, who come up to me, who take selfies with me, hashtag Twist Nation. And I thought of those t-shirts and I just kept revisiting that. And I immediately knew that I was going to want to, when I felt ready, go public, because I felt like I owed all those little girls an explanation. My husband says I don't, you know, that everything doesn't have to be political. The reality is that I'm black and I'm a black woman and I'm a black woman in politics, and everything I do is political. I think you might overly intellectualize it and say, it's just hair. People are well-meaning and have been reminding me of the India Arie song, you know, I'm not my hair, you are not your hair. And that's true, but I still want it. So I'm trying to find my way here. And I do believe going public will help. This is my official public revealing. I'm ready now because I want to be freed from the secret and the shame that that secret carries with it. And because I'm not here just to occupy space, I'm here to create it. And I want to be free. I am making peace with having alopecia. I have not arrived there. I'm very early in my alopecia journey. But I'm making progress every day. And that's why I'm doing this today. It's about self-agency. It's about power. It's about acceptance. Right now on this journey, when I feel the most unlike myself, is when I am wearing a wig. So I think that means I'm on my way.
Brooke, I want to go to you first. The response has been incredible. When she posted this, first of all, The Root posted this. When she posted her tweet on this yesterday, it's at 9,827 retweets and 61,200 likes.
This was so powerful. I saw this yesterday and I was in fear. It was so, I don't often watch, you know, like on your phone, a video that long, just a clip, and I had to stop what I was doing and watch that. It was so powerful. And she said something in there, you know, I'm not just here to occupy space, I'm here to create it. And that's so important. And how she kept making clear that, you know, her life as a black woman will always be political. Everything that she does, her existence is political. And I felt this is so powerful because I think alopecia is something a lot of black women struggle with, whether it be fraction alopecia, whether it be alopecia affecting you like it is the congresswoman here. And just as much as her twists were representative of so many young women, right? So many girls, so many women, and how the power in that, this is too. And I think that this was incredibly important. And she also said something, this happened in the fall. This started happening in the fall. And so this just happened to her. She's barely getting time to sit with it herself and just realizing the power. I think that's a sacrifice, just being willing to go public with something that she hasn't had that much time to sit with herself. This was really powerful. And I think Congresswoman Pressley, it's always a bummer to me that the four women, the squad, get looped together in a way that each of them as individuals, I feel like don't get enough shine, their history and their work and what they do. And I think, of course, there's power in the four of them together, but there's also so much about Congresswoman Pressley that I feel people don't know. And this is just part of it. And I thought this was powerful and this was amazing and just one of the great things about her.
Dr. Carter, when you think about this, when you think about just the reaction that, you know, for a congresswoman to do this, when Congresswoman out of New Jersey, why is it escaping me right now, Bonnie Coleman, mm-hmm. When she was going through cancer treatment, mm-hmm. and had all her hair shaved off, mm-hmm. and folks were like, oh my God, what happened? I know of another mm-hmm. Member of Congress who was going through cancer treatments and didn't want to do that and was wearing a wig, so and didn't want anybody to know what was going on. And so certainly powerful for her to step out and do this publicly.
Yeah, and I think just being real about mourning the loss of your hair and that not being a shallow concern. You know, I know she said people are trying to be helpful and they're trying to give you encouragement, but it's something that you didn't ask for. It's not something that you chose for yourself. This is something that is happening to you, right? This is your body sort of betraying you. And for women, I think our attractiveness, our femininity, so much of who we are is wrapped up in our hair and changing our hair and being able to sort of play with it, or choosing to cut it or have it long, and for that to no longer be a choice anymore when you are in alone in your home, that's hard enough. But when you are a person in the public eye and you're under so much scrutiny, I mean, people are taking pictures of her every day. People are looking at her every day. And I'm certain up until this moment, there was probably a lot of fear that one day that wig would slip or that somebody be able to say, hey, that's a unit she has on. That's not actually her hair, and what that must have felt like. So, I mean, this is probably the fourth time I've washed it this week, in part because I think we, at least for me, I'd never seen a woman of her stature and in her position come out and say, this is who I am now. I'm not all the way there. I'm learning to accept it. I'm still going through all the emotions, the trauma, even the sort of excitement, because she talks toward the end about the ability to sort of mess around with wigs and play with her look. Like, that's exciting, but it's still a journey. And I think for a lot of women, I know women who have alopecia, it is still a very difficult place to get to because of how we have all these anxieties around our hair.
Cleo, I mean, for her to come out publicly, I'm gonna show some photos in a minute. It's also freed a lot of other women mm-hmm. who are going through this, and folks have been sharing their story mm-hmm. about what they've been also been going through.
The Congresswoman has always been impressive. I mean, she's an impressive sister. Mm-hmm. And she's doing a couple of things in a row. As you mentioned, black women, probably more than most women in this country, have to deal with hair anxiety and concern about hair and being treated one way or the other based on hair. And this sister, in the beginning, affirmed African textured hair and braids, et cetera, and went on to affirm being bald. And what's powerful about the image that you just put up is that she's beautiful. You know, she's a stunning, bad sister, regardless. And she's brilliant. And I'm glad she's there. And she's somebody who's very nuanced, because not only is she a congresswoman who steps up and who speaks truth to power and is very impressive in that way, she's just impressive symbolically as a brilliant, strong sister. Now she's symbolically powerful as someone dealing with this hair issue and still stepping up and shining. And I think other women who are dealing with the same thing will feel more comfortable about who they are. And that's powerful to do that twice, mm-hmm. you know, to do that around black hair and to do that about hairlessness. Mm-hmm. She's just very impressive. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad to be around to see the squad, including that sister, in terms of how she represents.
Henry, are you seeing these photos that I'm playing on the iPad? If so, go ahead and pull those up as we have this conversation. These are some of the images that women have been posting on a Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley's timeline. Showing about that. And back to you, Brooke. When you talk about this reveal, again, being this public figure, being somebody who didn't have to do this. She could have just been living her own world, but she chose to. So, your thoughts on that.
It's just all about representation. And yeah, just that you, like I said earlier, you know, not only did she not have to, but this just happened to her. This happened so soon. And just the willingness to, I think, just be there for other women. She knows what this is going to do. She knows that this is going to be representative for a lot of women. And that's what that's about. You have to see the pictures rolling in. And a lot of people, I think there was a story of a I want to say a makeup artist in Memphis also dealing with alopecia and just, I think, the strength in numbers and just the power in someone in that position being willing to come out and show herself bald and to everyone, someone who faces so much criticism at disproportionately compared to, you know, a lot of other public figures, a lot of other politicians, and still being willing to do this because she knows what it could mean to so many other women. It's just so strong.
Also, I think that
it's what I've come to expect from Congresswoman Pressley.
Also, I think that a lot of people, again, are realizing for the first, wow, I never even knew about this, even to the extent of how it impacts folks. I mean, like this sister right here says she's been dealing with this for 10 years. Mm-hmm. And others have said, well, you know, patches. Matter of fact, I think Goldie, I'll pull up in a second. I think Goldie Taylor, she said that she had posted a tweet, says she had dealt with this a long time ago, but her hair came back. Mm-hmm. And so for some people, they grow their hair back. Others, never comes back.
Right, absolutely. And I think that's the permanence of it, right? It's sort of just becoming a new normal and becoming a new version of yourself that you didn't ask for or anticipate. And I don't know, you know, at any age if that's an easy thing to do, but I'm sure certainly as a woman, a mother, a wife, and all these things in contending with something that you could not foresee, right? Like, had no expectation that this was going to happen. And as Brooke rightly points out, probably happening at one of the most inconvenient times, right? I mean, I don't know if there's a convenient time to lose your hair, but certainly not when you have to go to the floor, right, and talk about something as large as impeachment and sort of the future of this country. So, you know, kudos to Representative Pressley for her honesty and her vulnerability, because I think she said a lot in that 7 minutes where she's talking about it's not all triumphant and feeling like a failure and feeling all of those things at the same time and trying to manage your own self.
You know, it's interesting, Cleo. So somebody on YouTube just posted, said, who put in her head that how she looks isn't attractive in a positive way? Look, let's just, first of all, That's a ridiculous question. And the reason it's a ridiculous question is because we live in a society that we that bombards us with so many different images that these things make who we are. There's a reason why the makeup industry earns billions upon billions. And when Alicia Keys announced that she was going to go makeup free, folks like, oh my God, well, you know, what are you doing? Because this society has said to women, put makeup on, put makeup on, cover up any blemish that you have. When you talk about the hair industry, I mean, billions of dollars made, and not just with women, billions with men. It is amazing to me the number of people who, let me be clear, I don't give a shit what any of you think. It is amazing to me the number of people, I don't give a...
You already said it.
No. Go give some. Like, if I can just be real clear, I give zero fucks. Zero. When people go on my Instagram page and go, you should cut all your hair off, I don't give a shit what y'all think, and I don't think about it. When folks were like, I remember I was at the radio station when I was working in Chicago, they were like, I think your hair is thinning. I was like, oh, okay. I'm literally not sitting here going, oh my God. Oh my. You actually think that I would spend a dime on a hair plug, on a tube? Hell no. And I'm going, if I don't give a damn, why do you? But there are people who literally, their whole worldview is locked up in, no, I gotta have a full head of hair. I've gotta have, I'm like, man, please. Well, so that's why that question.
Well, I think the question, it called itself affirming her, like telling her she should not be self-conscious about how she looks because she's beautiful. I think that was the intention.
Well, the question was, who put it in her head?
Yeah.
Easily.
The world.
The world. Right. I mean, television. Radio. I mean, you go down the line.
Roland, how many times have you heard somebody in any kind of media platform with your stature at least say, I don't give a flying Fruit Loops, you know what you said about most people do. I think it's a, frankly, yes. It's a weakness, and it's sad that we're that superficial and people's value is based on how well they make up themselves. But that's the reality that we live in, and you are one, and I think I'm pretty much that same way, who doesn't run around being concerned about it. And one of the powerful things about what the Congresswoman did is maybe less people will be self-conscious about the whole thing, because she shines regardless of this whole thing, and maybe others will realize they have that capacity as well. But I think, again, that this brother or sister, I don't know what they were, called themselves, saying, why is she even questioning anything based on how she looks? And you're asking the question, because society does.
Yeah. I mean, Brooke, I mean, I think about the people who go on Twitter and Instagram, look at LeBron James' hairline. Do you actually think LeBron James cares about any of these folks? But there are people who, they're so caught up in this.
It's the Western world.
That it drives everything. And look, we know right now, you got, in African nations, they are spending stupid money on bleaching cream.
Mm-hmm. Caribbean,
I mean, and all things along those lines. And so we live in a world where people want to dictate what you should look like, what you should care about. And matter of fact, wait a minute, this show, when we started this show here, Jay Feldman, my man, who's my, you know, longtime TV executive producer, Jay was like in the budget. Jay said, okay, we're going to do about a makeup artist. I said, we ain't going to have one. Now, look, I understand that's a job. I understand that. Mm-hmm. But my whole deal was, I don't give a damn about no makeup artist. Because in the television industry, it's no. You can't go on TV without makeup. Mm-hmm. You can't. No. We got to. Oh, no. You got forehead shine. So we got to sit. And I said, let me tell you something. I am not. I said, first of all, I ain't paying myself. A damn show ain't going to pay somebody else to put some makeup on the show, because I don't care. I don't care. But that's where we are.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. And I'm not at all take away from, like, the strength of you personally not caring, right? But I do think, I mean, we've got to admit, it is easier for men. It's easier for men to get to a point to where public figures, where they don't care.
It
I think there was
to be.
A story, I want to say it was in Australia, but there was a co-anchor, a man and a woman, and the man wore the same suit every single day for a year. Nobody noticed. But people bag on what the woman is wearing every single day.
Now, nobody let me be real clear. His ass wore the same damn suit every day. That suit was funky on some of them days.
No, very true. But, I mean, and I think social media has made this worse. And
yeah,
I think,
that's
I'm a
true.
Fan of social media. I'm not
very
one of those
true.
Like, yeah, social media. But social media has made this worse because people don't check themselves. Everybody's going to gossip. People are always going to gossip. People are always going to have opinions on other people that you keep to yourself. But, like, you wouldn't walk up to a stranger at the mall and say, I don't like your lipstick. I think you should do something different with your hair, because that's weird. But for some reason, behind the screen, you know, people feel like they can send you an email, they can send you a tweet.
Oh,
they
yeah.
can text you and say, tell you what they think about your appearance. And it's weird.
I mean, literally, I'll post photos and people sit here and go, you've lost all your hair. And I'm going, I don't think I've lost all my hair. I'm sitting trying to figure out. I mean, it's not like I'm walking around with a little bitty ass patch, like right there, and I ain't got no. Okay, here's my whole deal. Okay, if you walk around like with a little patch right here, okay, and you ain't got literally no hair on the side, the top, whatever, okay, you can have that conversation. But y'all, I'm sorry. It's ridiculous, and I think what's gonna happen is, I think when Alicia Keys did what she did, it caused some women who, frankly, are not in industries where it's like, no, you gotta have makeup, to say, why in the hell am I sitting there putting makeup on? And I think Congresswoman Pressley, by her putting this video out, is going to also liberate mm-hmm. some other people, just like we've seen a huge resurgence, a huge increase in women, especially in the television industry, but even in corporate America and others who said, you know what, I'm wearing my hair natural. I'm not sitting here walking around going to get that damn perm every 2 weeks.
I mean, and listen, I think there are a lot of choices. I mean, you can choose to do makeup, no makeup. I think what...
It's all your choice.
It's all your choice, but I think what Brooke was expressing is how for women that choice doesn't feel like a real choice because it's like, oh, you look terrible. You got bags.
Right.
Well, fix yourself up, right? I mean, and it is, I think, an additional pressure because of the way that women are scrutinized as opposed to men because men can still be good looking, right, without hair, right? Like, there's a whole sort of lineage of men who've been bald through time that people thought were extremely good looking, attractive, sexy, all of that. And when you're a woman and you do say, you know, I'm not going to wear makeup or I'm just going to honor my hair and let it do what it does on its own, it's, you know, taken as somehow you're not putting in any effort, right? And I think there is, and with social media and filters and all this other stuff where people can kind of get these overinflated senses of what they look like, you can Photoshop yourself and be whatever you want to be, it really has made us have these unrealistic expectations of what people actually look like, men and women.
Yep. All right, folks, Brooke's got to go, so do me a favor, please. I want y'all to go download her podcast, Controlling Our Narrative podcast. Brooke, thanks a lot.
Take care, Brooke.
Thanks for having me. It's always really great. Thank you.
You want to check out Roland Martin Unfiltered? YouTube.com/RolandSMartin. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. There's only one daily digital show out here that keeps it black and keep it real. It's Roland Martin Unfiltered. See that name right there? Roland Martin Unfiltered. Like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. That's youtube.com/RolandSMartin. And don't forget to turn on your notifications so when we go live, you'll know it. Martin.